My name is Nicola Walker, and I'd like to tell you about the Whitworth, part of the University of Manchester, and the work we did to ultimately win the coveted ArtFund Museum of the Year Award in 2015. Manchester, located in the northwest of England, famous for its cotton mills and the birth of the Industrial Revolution, birthplace of Emmeline Pankhurst, founder of the suffragette movement, a vibrant city with many cultural institutions, and known also for a couple of football clubs. The Whitworth was founded in 1889 with money left by local engineer Sir Joseph Whitworth, whose main claim to fame was the standardisation of the screw thread. The first building, Grove House, was a Victorian villa set in Parkland just south of Manchester city centre. The park itself had many features, including a boating lake and bandstand, pathways, trees and flower beds designed for the working people of Manchester to use in their leisure time. The gallery acquired important collections and displayed them according to the fashion of the time in large top-lit galleries and as seen here beneath replicas of the Elgin marbles. In 1959, the gallery was taken over by the University of Manchester, heralding a dramatic change in its fortunes and a radical redesign. Architects John Bickerdike Allen and partners transformed the gallery, creating a Scandinavian-inspired modernist interior. A mezzanine level was inserted into the centre of the building, creating intimate spaces suitable for the display of many of the gallery's collections. These galleries still form the main part of the building, where we display our internationally renowned collections of works of art on paper, textiles and wallpapers. In 1995, a further architectural intervention gave us a large sculpture court in a space that had previously been an external light well. Like all our galleries, this space is flexible and used in many different ways. Despite the changes over the last century, by 2008, the gallery's ambitions had outgrown the old Victorian building, and we needed to expand. So we set about creating a vision for the future, developing a brief and bidding to funders, including the Heritage Lottery Fund, Arts Council England, and other major donors. Key elements of the brief to the design team included making better connections with our adjacent park, expanding new exhibition galleries, improving access to our collections, developing new audiences, and embedding sustainability across all our activities. We held an architectural competition which attracted 139 expressions of interest from all over the globe. And in October 2009, appointed MUMA, McInnes Usher McKnight Architects, a London-based practice with experience of working on galleries and historic buildings. They had just completed work on the V&A's medieval and Renaissance galleries. This image is from MUMA's first sketchbook and responds to a quote by former gallery director Margaret Pilkington, who wrote, "I have come to the conclusion that a good museum or gallery should be a place where people feel comfortable. If it stands in a garden or park, the visitor should be able to enjoy the beauty of the outside as a counterpoint to what is within." Sadly, unlike the front of our building, the back of the building facing onto the park was a neglected and unwelcoming sight. But all that was about to change. MUMA's design included elegant wings extending out into the park, housing a new exhibition gallery, study centre, learning studio and cafe, while an airy promenade overlooking an art garden wraps itself around the back of the original building. In 2012, we set about decanting our collections, and for a period of 1 year, with building contractors already on site, we continued to function as an open public gallery. Then, on the 31st of August 2013, we closed to the public with a 3-day festival in the park celebrating everything good about the Whitworth, from our programmes of activities for families, to cutting-edge contemporary art, in this case, a work entitled Six White Horses, an enchanting durational installation by artists Nick Crowe and Ian Rawlinson. And finally, very Whitworth and very Manchester, a late-night party with music and fireworks. Over a total period of 2 years and 3 months, our new building gradually took shape. The project included refurbishment of existing spaces, in this case, our suite of temporary exhibition galleries, and the new extension. My role in the midst of all this was as client liaison between gallery staff and the design team and the contractors. And here I am one day without an office, just sitting on the floor. And while we transformed our building, we were the most open, closed museum ever encountered. And it was this element of our work that formed the basis of our bid to become Museum of the Year. Our most ambitious project saw a pop-up gallery in Selfridge's department store, seen by their 200,000 plus customers as part of a festival of the imagination. Including Epstein's Genesis, seen here, and works by Dürer, Picasso, and Emin, amongst others, the exhibition was central to a programme of workshops, talks, and debates. Our learning and engagement team ran extensive off-site activities at 30 sites across the city, directly engaging 6,900 people of all ages, many of whom had never visited the gallery before. This is a toddler-tastic workshop based in the Bridgewater Hall, the city's main venue for classical music. We worked in unexpected environments, such as a local supermarket, Asda, making lots of friends and forging new partnerships. Teenagers from our neighbouring school worked with our contractors, learning about the construction process and also digging up clay from the site, which they then used to make ceramic buttons and badges, which were later sold in the gallery shop. Team members worked within communities on our doorstep, forging outreach partnerships with the university teaching hospitals. While an increasing focus on age-friendly work resulted in a placement in a residential care home. And you can't be in Manchester without having a drink. So for our young adult audience, those over 18, the culture-based Whitworth pub crawl was a must. And throughout the whole period, despite limited access to our collections, we facilitated the loan of 200 objects to 40 worldwide venues. While several touring exhibitions, including Turner's to London and a watercolour exhibition to Japan, kept our national and international profile high. And finally, in February 2015, a new building and a new brand. And I have to point out to you here the lovely motif at the top and the bottom, inspired by Whitworth's standard screw thread. We still inhabit our grand Victorian building, albeit with improved disabled access. And have restored our grand hall, converted in the 1970s to study rooms and offices, into a multifunctional room for workshops, lectures, and conferences, or for concerts, banquets, and weddings. But our beautiful new extension has transformed the park-facing side of the building and finally realises the Whitworth's potential as a gallery in a park, with our founding mission to be for the perpetual gratification of the people of Manchester. Harking back to the quote in Moomer's sketchbook, our light-filled promenades allow us views out to the surrounding landscape and from the park offer enticing glimpses to the art inside. And I'm going to let you see the next images and let them speak for themselves. This is a favourite window on our new grand staircase, and to quote the speaker yesterday from Kyoto, gives us a highly curated view of the outside world. Presiding over the art garden is Nathan Coley's Gathering of Strangers, a new acquisition articulating our aspiration for the Whitworth, a place where strangers meet and feel welcomed. Has our new building fulfilled the brief? The first exhibition in our refurbished exhibition galleries was the work of British artist Cornelia Parker and includes work that previously we would not have been able to show, including Cold Dark Matter on loan from Tate, and a new commission, War Room, made from the paper left behind from Remembrance Day poppies. It was fitting to include Cornelia's reinterpretation of Rodin's The Kiss as we open to the public on St. Valentine's Day. Our new landscape gallery is essentially a simple white box that we can adapt in many ways. And as the Whitworth never does anything by halves, for the first exhibition, we created a lake reflecting the Chinese landscape drawings on exhibition. Having increased public space by 100%, we are able to accommodate our growing audiences and to show more of our collection. Access to our collections has improved on many levels. A rationalisation of spaces back of house means the majority of our collections are stored on site in three central and adjacent passively conditioned rooms. Collections are more efficiently housed according to storage method rather than object type. A dedicated conservation room at gallery level enables our collection care team to engage with the public. Our new study centre provides one-to-one contact for researchers with collections and curatorial expertise. This is by appointment, but open to all, whether academic researchers, special interest groups, or an individual member of the public. It also acts as a teaching space that accommodates student groups, allowing collections to be integrated into university teaching. Completely new to us is our collection centre, an informal display area providing insights into the collection and curated by external voices. Based on our textiles and wallpaper collections, one of the most popular displays so far has been Toddler's Choice, and it was exactly that. And continuing the theme, our age-inclusive approach to the arts in Manchester has been rightly recognised nationally as innovative, original, and inspirational. Formal learning continues to take place in our exhibition galleries and with our collections, while the dedicated learning studio is a place where learning from our collections can be translated into creativity. A flexible space for book school sessions or drop-in family activities, and a place to be a great artist and to make as much mess as you like. A key element in our brief to the design team was to embed sustainability across all our activities. We have broadened our environmental parameters and have adopted a passive environmental approach in both our exhibition galleries and stores. We no longer have air conditioning and control relative humidity by a conservation heating approach. All our lighting is LED and we use daylight where possible. And we have sensors on our exhibition lighting track, which enables us to set cumulative light readings over the duration of an exhibition. Information around the gallery, including signs on the back of the toilet doors, informs visitors about our approach. We have planted a wildflower meadow, focus on native species in our landscaping, have beehives on the roof, and encourage both visitors and staff to travel green. And both our shop and cafe source local, fair trade, and sustainable products. And what of our desire to connect with our surrounding landscape? The beautiful art garden designed by Chelsea Gold Medal winner Sarah Price perfectly integrates the gallery with the surrounding park. And a private and quiet orchard garden is a welcome space for reflection in a busy urban environment. Park and gallery is a site of participation and a perfect venue for large-scale events. Or, as on one of our welly walks, for a bit of quiet time alone to get to grips with the wonders of nature. Following on from our outreach work in hospitals, we have established an accredited volunteer horticultural therapy programme supported by mental health charities. On a sunny day, our art garden becomes a space of creativity for a primary school group. And an opportunity for these secondary school pupils to follow our sculpture trail where we have extended art beyond our walls. And this is a new commission, Ghost Tree by Anna Galaccio. Weekend activities such as storytelling, always with a connection to our collections, attracts local families and many repeat visitors. And if the sunshine turns to familiar Manchester rain, then we just bring the deck chairs indoors. For the first time, our expanded building allows us to provide extensive volunteering opportunities for people from neighbouring communities. Art gardeners help maintain outdoor areas, in this case, a young man keen to take up a career in horticulture. While collections volunteers offer assistance to visitors accessing our collections. 2015 was truly a year of celebrations for the Whitworth, and a lot of champagne has been drunk. Since we have reopened, we have won 17 architectural and museum awards and been shortlisted for a further 8. In terms of the museum community, this has been the story of how the Whitworth was awarded ArtFund Museum of the Year in 2015. And finally, if you know the Whitworth but haven't been since we reopened, then come and fall in love again. And if you are new to us, then just come and fall in love. Thank you.